and Harper Audio present When We Were Friends by Holly Bourne, performed by Heather Long.
31. If I'd known Jessica was going to turn up unexpectedly after all this time, I would have worn a different outfit. Though, it's not as if that would have stopped her looking better than me. And no outfit could rescue my general limp appearance that day. I'd woken up to a vibrating notification from my period tracking app. Warning, you may be experiencing PMS symptoms today.
What is it?
Ben had asked, in a voice thick with sleep. I'd kissed his creased face and handed over my phone. He read the screen and smiled. Thanks for the heads up. I'll get my panic room ready. He cradled my head and kissed me quickly on the lips before returning my phone and rolling out of bed to get ready for work. I grinned as I listened to him sing in the shower, shifting to lie in the leftover warmth of his sleeping body. I inhaled his scent on the pillow and couldn't imagine any PMS capable of breaking through my Ben-induced oxytocin. My boyfriend emerged dripping in a towel, looking both cute and sexy.
How are you feeling about tonight?
It'll be fine, I sighed. The thought of the upcoming evening curdled the edges of my good mood. It's not like I sell out every day.
You're not selling out, Ben repeated for the 20th time.
He leant over to kiss me, sprinkling me with drops of shower water. Remember, Fern, some days you just need to do your job and pay the rent. He glanced at the time on his phone to check he wasn't late. If this author, he made air quotes with his fingers, says some stupid things, then that's on her, not you.
Stop being so nice to me. If you're now going to dare leave for work when you're so naked and brilliant, I groaned.
He laughed into my mouth as he kissed me, and I felt positively sickened by my own happiness.
I've got to go.
Ben gave me a final kiss before straightening up and pulling a shirt and trousers over his damp body. After he'd finished brushing his teeth, he appeared in the doorway with a breakfast bar in his hand to eat on the bus. See you later, gorgeous. Message me when the event's over. You're going to smash it. He picked up my phone, which still had the warning up.
When you look at the PMS dark side, careful you must be,
he said in a Yoda voice. I couldn't help my smile. You're ridiculous and I love you. You too. Oh shit, late. Always, always late. Right, gotta go. When the front door clicked behind him, I sank again into the glorious smell of his pillow. Of course, it didn't take long for the app to be proved correct. My best friend, Heather, messaged me to say she wouldn't be able to make it that night as she'd been given a last-minute late shift at the clinic. I dropped my toast peanut butter side down, spilt legions of coffee over my notes for that evening, and couldn't get through week 5 of my Couch to 5K app. After I showered off the sweat from my failed run, I found my body had swollen like proven dough. My chosen outfit, which had looked fine a week earlier, now taunted me with its clinginess. Despite my shower, my hair still had a greasy sheen to it and hung lankly around my shoulders. I tried curling it, but burnt my neck, flinging my GHDs onto the carpet and calling them a self-satisfied pair of cunts. These cunts proceeded to singe our landlord's acrylic carpet in retaliation, and it was just as well I hadn't applied makeup yet, as I actually rage-cried for a full minute. By the time I left for the event, I'd masked my low mood and estrogen levels with red lipstick and arranged my hair so it covered my GHD hickey. I wore an old and reliable black long-sleeve jumpsuit and had gold heels I'd change into when I got to the venue. I was pelted with long strings of rain as I ran to the bus stop, soaked by the time I reached shelter. I checked my appearance using the selfie mode on my phone and admitted defeat. This was just going to be a ball ache of a day, with the event still to come. At least no one you know is coming, I reassured myself, as the bus hissed its way around the corner, splashing the bottom of my jumpsuit with puddle water.
Fern, you made it. Oh my God, isn't the weather terrible?
Gwen, the bookshop's event manager, met me with the standard publishing industry 2 air kisses.
February is a very determined month, I said, while my umbrella dripped onto her brogues. Oh no, I've made you wet, sorry.
She waved her hand. Don't worry. Right, sit down. Can I get you anything? Tea, coffee, wine? Stacey isn't here yet.
Gwen checked her watch as she clattered over to a laden table and started putting food I'd not asked for onto a paper plate. She checked the time again as she dumped freshly cut melon onto my palm.
Oh, right. Thank you. Stacey's just posted an Insta story on her way here. She's on her way from the hairdresser, stuck in traffic by all the rain.
Gwen twitched.
Oh, yes. Okay. Have you seen the queue outside? They've arrived so early. They're all going to be soaked. I'm sure they're too excited to care.
I pushed a watermelon slab into my mouth to stop me making a sarcastic comment.
Shall I show you the stage setup? I know you've done this loads of times before, but can't hurt to go over it, can it?
I sensed it was to ease her nerves rather than mine, but nodded and followed her scuttling through the corridors out onto the giant empty stage. Stacey was too big for her events to fit into a bookshop, so they'd hired out a theatre. Gwen and I stepped out into the blinding lights while a technician paced around the stage, clapping at different moments. A jolt of nerves went through me. So many people would be witnessing this damn carry-on. Stacey's publishers had done a paid partnership with GAR, the website I worked at, and wanted me to chair the event to give her autobiography credibility. From what I'd been told, we couldn't afford to turn down the advertorial, and I was stuck pretending to like a book I'd thrown across the room 7 times the previous weekend.
It's dangerous and outdated nonsense. I don't think Stacey's ever met a psychologist, I told Ben, both before and after lunch, and twice more before bedtime. And yet, GAR are splashing it all over their homepage for a whole week.
He laughed and lowered his lips onto my eyelids. And just think, out of all the chairpersons they could have chosen to peddle such misinformation, they chose you. I stared out at the ocean of space.
That's a lot of seats, I said.
Gwen grinned. It sold out in an hour, did I tell you? One of the quickest we've had. Do direct them to buy the book at the beginning and the end. So many people forget.
Of course.
Shall I show you the GAR stand?
The what?
She led me past a side table dwarfed by the wobbling piles of Stacey's book. Hulking, hot pink hardbacks towered towards the high ceiling, and just past it was a sorrowful-looking table with the GAR banner above it, loaded with some promotional keyrings I doubted anyone wanted.
That's your table. It'll be nice for you to be able to chat to people afterwards.
Oh, great, I said, immediately furious at my editor Derek for not telling me about this part of the evening. Nobody mentioned me having to loiter around some stand afterwards. Gwen's phone went, and she leapt on it, her eyes wide with relief.
Stacey's here, she told me, as if Beyonce had just arrived. Quick!
Can you believe this weather?
Stacey bellowed to everyone, rushing into the green room with her tiny publicist, knowing she didn't need to introduce herself.
I spent so long getting my hair perfect, and all for what? Oh my God, it makes you want to kill yourself. Whoops, bad joke. You know me. Hey, do you guys have a phone charger I can use? Cheers.
Stacey snatched a lead from Gwen's twitching hands, then spied the snacks.
Oh, cakes, yummy. Is this all for me? How sweet.
We all hovered and watched Stacey eat a cupcake while I wondered when I should introduce myself. The young influencer had clearly made a book launch outfit mood board at some point after Googling what writers look like. Gone was her usual array of erratic, revealing clothing. Instead, she'd poured herself into a crisp white shirt with skinny tie, dark blue jeans, heels, and gathered her hair into a professional ponytail topped off with prescription-free large-rimmed glasses.
Wow, watermelon too? Oh, this is great.
She pulled out her phone.
Look, everyone outside is so excited.
Stacey fell down a social media rabbit hole, and it was now slightly weird she hadn't said hello to anyone. I coughed to alert her publicist, who was also buried in her phone. She looked up, and I saw the obvious effort it took her to pretend enthusiasm for me.
You must be Fern. Oh my, lovely to meet you.
She launched herself up and air-kissed me. Nice to meet you too. How's it been going?
Oh, crazy, just crazy. We found out today we hit the bestseller list though, after only 3 days of sales.
That's wonderful.
So much thanks to you and Gar, of course.
We were so happy to support Stacey. Stacey, behind us, held up her phone and started filming a video to post. This, ladies, gentlemen and everyone in between, is what a green room looks like, she said, narrating herself without a whiff of self-consciousness. I sucked my stomach in as the lens swept over me, pretending I didn't know I was being beamed to over 450,000 followers. Stacey, are you free for a second? I'd like you to meet Fern, your amazing chair. The influencer stood up to shake hands.
It's great to meet you.
She smiled with the full wattage, as if I was one of her fans.
Fern, was it?
Her publicist filled her in.
Fern's the mental health editor of the GAR website, and she founded the Hold On for Tomorrow project. You know, that blog post that went viral a few years ago, encouraging people to post reasons to stay alive? She started that.
I watched Stacey's expression as she realised I was actually quite relevant.
Oh my God, of course that was you. I loved that project. I knew I recognised you from somewhere. We must take a photo. Hayley, could you?
She tossed her phone to her publicist and smooshed her face against mine. Awkwardness reined my body as I tried to pose in a way that didn't make me look as if I was trying to get down with the youth. I was highly aware of my eye wrinkles compared to Stacey's smoothly made-up face, one of her many youth privileges, like being able to shop at Boohoo without looking like mutton, and her instant understanding of TikTok, the gender spectrum, and which brand of oat milk was morally questionable that week. The phone clicked, and Stacey grabbed it back, zooming in on her own face before pocketing it.
It's great to meet you too, I gushed. I loved the book.
This was the toll I'd found you must always pay in the publishing industry. You must first lie that you'd read the book the whole way through, and then you lie about having loved it. Stacey accepted my payment, smiled, and offered up an equally inauthentic response.
Oh, really? Thank you. That means so much coming from you, Fern.
Me, a woman who needed formal identification less than 2 minutes ago. We grinned inanely at one another, our cheeks aching.
Do you have a few minutes to go through the event? I asked.
My questions? Her nose wrinkled.
Do you mind if we didn't? I feel like I lose my flow if I know what's coming up, you know?
Oh, of course. Hayley, the publicist, appeared at my side while Stacey sat down again and disappeared through the portal of her phone screen.
Stacey's just so comfortable in front of her followers that it all flows really easily.
She reassured me.
Of course. Honestly, just let Stacey be Stacey and it will be amazing.
Of course. Of course, the event was the train wreck I knew it was going to be from the moment I'd read her book. Not that anyone else, A, noticed the train wreck or B, minded it. At least my reputation and Gar's didn't appear to be harmed by it. In fact, as Stacey had so kindly tagged me into her socials afterwards, I was privy to the hundreds of her fans crying and shaking at the beautiful energy of the inspirational evening. It was the easiest money I'd made in a long while. After we'd been mic'd up, we emerged in front of hundreds of cheering faces, and as chair, I had to ask only one question to fill the 40 minutes.
So, tell me, Stacey, what led you to write this book?
Stacey spurted into a manic monologue that was literally impossible to interrupt, even when she started sharing in explicit detail the exact methodologies by which she'd considered killing herself when she got cancelled after a viral YouTube video and discussing the success rates of each one. I winced and tried to interject as she broke every single Samaritan's safeguarding guideline. As I watched this 24-year-old talk about her gritty breakup, half of me wanted to hug her, and the other half wanted to throw one mental health book at her that wasn't her ghost-written autobiography. Instead, I arranged my face into nothingness and reminded myself this was on Gar, not me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.